Walt Disney's best animators were like star actors. And like actors, they fit some roles better than others. Some were unbeatable at slapstick.
Look at that! Bad boy!
2 days slow, that's what it is.
Some loved bigger-than-life action. Others drew straight from the heart. Milt Kahl was the one Disney animator who could take on any role. He was the Olivier of animation.
All these guys, they're like actors, you know. They all have their ego, and I think they all think they're the best, you know. And I'm no exception.
The lines and proportions on Milt Kahl's characters were the standard for other Disney animators.
I think my main asset is the fact that I didn't have any limitations, you see. I could do anything.
His characters ran the gamut from killers to comedians.
Well, it sounds a little bit egotistical, but I turned out to be just made for that medium.
The range of Milt Kahl's performances makes him a virtuoso among animators. This is his story in the Disney Family Album. Takes one to draw one. Milt Kahl's own life has all the variety of the characters he animated. He's always had a taste for sports cars, such as his Panther Roadster. One of his hobbies is tying flies for fly fishing the rivers of the Northwest. His fish stories include this animation of Slewfoot Sue. Delicate wire sculptures surround his home like dancers in a ballet chorus. Those poses come to life in his animation of The Prince and Briar Rose in Sleeping Beauty. Milt Kahl lives on an ocean bay north of San Francisco. His rich life got off to a humble start.
My parents were terribly poor. My father was had a little talent, but was not an educated man the least bit.
Milt Kahl quit high school in San Francisco in 1932. He worked for two newspapers, an ad agency, and as a freelance artist. It was the height of the Great Depression, and there weren't only bread lines. There were also lines to see Disney cartoons. Milt Kahl was in one of those lines the day he saw the light. The light was coming from a movie projector. The projector was playing Disney's The Three Little Pigs.
Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Big bad wolf, big bad wolf. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf?
When the Disney productions made The Three Little Pigs, that just really captivated me, and I just loved the medium, you know.
In 1934, Milt went to work at Disney, learning to make drawings that performed. Disney's studio was full of young artists like Kahl, working in the chorus as in-betweeners or assistants until they learned the steps. For many of the young people who worked there, Disney's studio took the place of college.
You know, Walt himself was pretty young then, too, you know. There were a great many gags pulled. I don't remember who it was for sure, but who... He had a little pet turtle. And... He got some special turtle food for it, and these guys would switch turtles on him. They began putting a little bit bigger turtle, a little bit bigger turtle, you know, every week or every few days, you know, and this thing was growing to beat hell, you know, and he just couldn't get over this, and all of a sudden they started reversing the process.
Milt Milt stepped into the spotlight as an animator in Mickey's Circus in 1936. His animation was memorable from the start. He conjured up spirits for lonesome ghosts. He kept the ugly duckling afloat. He took the bull by the horns. Ferdinand the Bull.
I did the voice of Ferdinand the Bull when he was... There's only one line in the picture when he's a little bull, you know. In fact, I think Walt did his mother. She said, "Ferdinand, why don't you go out and play with all the other little bulls and butt your head?" And he said,
"I like it better here."
I can't do the voice anymore.
Where I can just sit quietly and smell the flowers.
"Now, Ferdinand, why don't you play with all the other little bulls and butt your head?" But Ferdinand would shake his head.
"I like it better here, where I can sit just quietly and smell the flowers."
If not for Walt Disney, Milt Kahl would have been a performer without a stage.
It always has been amazing to me over these years that he kept this very diversified bunch of artists together, and people who were, so many of them, very rugged individualists, and people who didn't normally, to whom a Greek a group effort was foreign, you know, and he brought them all together and got good results and made good pictures.
Disney picked Milt for a starring role in Pinocchio, a performance that was a turning point in his career.
"The gift of life is thine."
What they can't do these days.
"I can move. I can talk. I can walk."
They were thinking in terms of a puppet all the time, naturally, because he was a puppet. And I didn't like what they had very much. And I handle it as a little boy, really.
"A little wooden boy. Now, who
a wooden boy?"
The fact that his arms and legs showed were wood didn't make any difference, you know. He's still basically a little boy. And Walt liked it very much. Then I was put in charge of the unit that did Pinocchio, you see. And so, I was a supervising animator on it, see. And that was a big jump for me, you know. That was that really got me started as being one of the top line people.
"On to the theater. Hi, diddly dee. An actor's life for me. A high silk hat and a silver cane. A watch of gold with a diamond chain. Hi, diddly."
If I had the right build and the right figure and the right face and all that, I could be a very good actor. An animator is a... You have to be part actor, part director, part story man. You know, you have to have a very good feeling for entertainment. What's entertainment and what isn't? You know, and so you're kind of a jack of all trades. As far you really are. The thing is, you're not limited by your sex or by your weight or anything. You can do anything.
"I'm tired of being only 3 inches high. Yeah.
The most difficult characters to animate. Humans.
You can do anything you want with animals, you know, because we're doing animals doing things that animals don't do. People aren't used to watching animals doing this, and so they're not critical. But they're used to watching people that move around and talk and do everything, and they become very, very critical of them, you know."
"Indeed."
Because they were hard to animate, they were often assigned to Milt Kahl.
The human characters that are difficult to do are the characters that are middle range. One of the worst ones I had to do was Johnny Appleseed. He was just a mild-mannered little guy who never got mad at anybody.
"The Lord is good to me, and so I thank the Lord.
for giving me the things I need, the sun and rain and an apple seed. Yes, he's been good to me.
Nobody could animate a handsome prince like Milt Kahl.
Good day.
Oh.
Hello.
I know you. I walked with you once upon a dream. I know you. The gleam in your eyes is so familiar, a gleam.
But while they might have been virtuoso performances, for Milt, they weren't much fun.
You have to accept these things. You have to accept them and do the best you can with them, you know. And you figure that you're always going to have characters in the picture that are entertaining, you know. So it doesn't hurt to have your straight jobs once in a while.
How do you draw characters in motion? Anything that moved, that Disney animators photographed and sketched. Beginning with Snow White in 1937, they studied live-action film. Milt Kahl, too, used live-action models, but the performances were always his own.
If you use live-action for reference, actually, truly, just for reference, that's great. I did this with Jungle Book. The way to use it, I think, is to learn so much about it that you don't have to use the reference anymore.
The Snow White animals had flour sack bodies. 5 years later, Bambi wobbled as only a deer or a Milt Kahl drawing of a deer could. Milt and the Disney animators had learned more about motion and anatomy than any group of artists in the world.
In appearance, physical appearance, we came as close to as we figured we possibly could to the real deer and still be able to articulate for dialogue and get and have a full range of expressions.
Go on, say hello.
Hello.
I think that I had as much to do with the Disney style, with creating a Disney style as anybody over the years.
The release of Bambi marked the end of an era for Milt and for the Disney studio. From 1942 to 1949, the only theaters that mattered were European and Asian theaters of war. Always a staunch patriot, Disney turned his studio over to the war effort. Milt Kahl worked as a stagehand instead of a star until the curtain came down on World War II.
Right in the poor's face.
I worked on Walt did a series of propaganda films. One was Education for Death. One was Reasoning and Emotion. I remember a scene in Education for Death when this mother is praying over her child. He wasn't going to get killed or get swept up in this Nazi movement or something.
Heil Hitler.
Was ist denn schon wieder los mit Hans? Ist denn schon wieder?
It was just a spot thing, and you never got to know this woman or anything. So, but I did enjoy just getting a good performance out of that one little thing there.
With the military in charge of his studio, Walt struck off for South America to make a series of films for the U.S. State Department.
On Saludos Amigos, that was one of those. I did a thing called Lake Titicaca, which featured the duck in Peru. And they had a llama in this thing that was kind of funny.
From 1942 to 1949, Disney produced only short cartoons played mainly for laughs. Milt Kahl on short cartoons? It was like Olivia joining the Three Stooges. At last, Milt found a challenge in Song of the South, a combination of animation and live action released in 1946.
The animated sections were Rather, I always thought a high for us. You know, they were, the characters were. Well, I've often said that if there's anything good about our pictures, it's because the characters were rich. Well, they were rich there. You know, they were very rich and very contrasting. You know, so you had this bear with a one track mind and the mind of a child, really. And he was very slow witted.
What I said was, I'm gonna knock his head clean off.
And then you had this very, very sharp-witted fox who outsmarted himself all the time, you know.
Please, Mother Fox, please don't fling me in that brown patch.
Brown patch?
Glad I thought of that. Yes, indeed. I sure am glad I thought of that.
But you ain't gonna fling me in there, is you?
Who, me? Oh, no. We ain't gonna do that.
And then you have the rabbit who's put on quite a show to outwit the fox, you know, and act like he was terribly scared, and especially when he got to outsmart him, got him to throw him in the briar patch, you know, where he was born and bred. After the war, I think the studio only had enough money to meet the payroll for 6 weeks. It was a very marginal thing. And I believe it was about that time when we all took a voluntary cut in our salaries. And that went on for about a year or two, you know, until they got back on their feet again.
What got them back on their feet was a return to the animated features beginning in 1949 with Cinderella.
Oh, God, everyone was delighted to get back to work on something that was important.
As audiences saw when they saw Cinderella's fairy godmother, Milt Kahl still had to touch with characters.
How's she doing?
Salagadoola, mentricaboola, bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Put them together, and what have you got? Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Salagadoola, mentricaboola, bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. It'll do magic, believe it or not. Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
I like the characters in Sword and the Stone very much. You know, Merlin was a very rich character. Lovers of the Arthur legend became incensed at the way we made Merlin a kind of a doddering magician, you know, and I thought that's where he had his charm, because he was sort of bumbling, you know.
All right, let's start again. Where was I, boy?
Hockety pockety?
Oh, yes, that's right. Pockety pockety wockety whack, odds and ends of brick and brick.
Be with you in just a minute, sir.
Packing's almost done.
You bungling blockhead!
Hey! Easy there! No, go ahead! Dum doodly 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 dum! This is the best part now. Higgitus figgitus miggitus boom! Prestidigitonium! Higgitus figgitus miggitus boom! Prestidigitonium!
What a way to pack!
On Sword in the Stone, the Serector. I made him a wobblehead because, you know, he was always, he ran that castle and had all the authority, and he when he talked, this is way of doing it. It really is self-assured.
Oh no, you don't. I'm running this place, and if you think you're gonna fiddle with my schedule, you'd better pack up your bag of tricks and be gone.
Let's take the sheriff of Nottingham and Robin Hood. He's a big pompous oaf who is very satisfied with himself and very good, you know, feels real good about everything, and especially about himself, you know. Well, so he has a real bouncy way of walking.
As the taxes due, and the taxes is due.
You see these things on people and you file them away in your mind somewhere.
Milt hasn't done much drawing since his retirement in 1976 after 42 years as an animator. A single drawing has no voice. A single drawing is not animation.
I actually don't really particularly care to draw. It's always been work for me. And what I love is where I get my kicks is to get that performance on the screens.
Power. Me?
One of Milt's favorite performances was Thumper the Rabbit in Bambi.
That's not a flower.
5-year-old Peter Bain was Thumper's voice.
That was kind of a nice thing because he couldn't remember his lines, you know. You had to feed him a few words at a time, you know. Mm-hmm. See, that's the only way you could do it. And he said he doesn't
walk very good, does he?
You know, you could say that.
He doesn't walk very good, does he?
Thumper?
Yes, Mama.
When Peter fluffed a line, Milt made it part of the scene.
If you can't say something nice, don't say nothing at all.
A character's voice can set the stage for an animator's performance. Such was the case with George Sanders, the voice of the tiger, Shere Khan, in The Jungle Book.
They were thinking of a kind of a Jack Palance type, you know, and a straight, evil character who was going to kill this kid, you know, and maybe enjoy him for dinner, you know. And so anyway, Ken Anderson made one drawing that... He was thinking of a basal Rathbone, kind of a supercilious, above-it-all tiger. He started looking around, and he finally got latched on to George Sanders, and he turned out to be just absolutely perfect.
I'd like a word with you, if you don't mind.
Shere Khan, what a surprise.
Yes, isn't it? I just dropped by. Forgive me if I've interrupted anything.
Oh, no, nothing at all.
I thought perhaps you were entertaining someone up there in your coils. Who is it, Carl?
No. Well, I was just singing to myself.
Indeed.
He grabs him by the throat and then scratches him with his claw up his nose, up his nostril, you know, and it's just terrible, but he's being so terribly polite and sympathetic.
A trust in me.
No, I can't be bothered with that. I have no time for that sort of nonsense.
Some other time, perhaps.
Perhaps.
Milt's final performance was one of his best. He drew most of Madame Medusa in The Rescuers, and he did it without using a live-action model, though he did get help from Geraldine Page, Medusa's voice.
Well, Geraldine Page is she's an absolutely magnificent actress. She has such a range to her voice, too. She goes into from falsetto to a deep growl, you know, and she has a tremendous range.
You get down there and find the big diamond, or you will never see that teddy again.
She has a marvelous feeling for comedy.
Brutus! Nero, stop that inferno racket! I mean now! Snoop's a mouse! Oh, kill it, kill it!
See, I saw quite a few of her pictures, too. I saw one with, I think Paul Newman played opposite her. It was called The Sweet Bird of Youth, I think. And there's a place in there where he tries to get near. She's on the telephone, and he tries to get near her, and she sticks her foot in his chest, you know, to keep him from away from the telephone. And... I always remembered that.
Poor Teddy. I'll just keep him up here with me where he'll be safe.
Give me back my teddy bear. He's mine. He's mine.
It was an awfully cruel thing to do and right in character with her.
If you get Milt Kahl to sit with a sketch pad for an encore, you see the fierce intensity that made him a virtuoso among animators. When Milt Kahl takes an encore, he brings a lot of characters back on stage.
Come on, everybody. Here we go!
On to the theater! Hi, diddly dee, an actor's life for me. A high silk hat and a silver cane, a watch of gold with a diamond chain. Hi, diddly day, an actor's life is gay. It's great to be a celebrity, an actor's life for me. To da di 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 da di di up da dum da dum di da di di da da dum di 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 da da dum da dum di di da di di up di di up da da. An actor's life for me. A high silk hat and a silver cane. A watch of gold with a diamond chain. I'm diddly day. An actor's life is gay. It's great to be a celebrity. An actor's life for me. To da di 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 da di di up da dum da da di da di di da da di 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 dum da dum da di di da di di up di di up da da.
Bravo, bravo. An extraordinary performance.
By the end of his career at Disney, Milt Kahl set standards so high, only he could reach them.
Geez, if you don't have something to aspire to, well, what have you got? You know, you have to have high standards. I think that's part of any profession. You have to... God, if you don't aim high, well, you're not going to get anywhere.